Due to a special broadcast, the following programs, usually presented over many of these stations, will not be seen tonight. Douglas Edwards and the News, sponsored by Oldsmobile, and the Perry Como Show, sponsored by Chesterfield Cigarettes. Douglas Edwards will return tomorrow night, and Perry Como will return Wednesday night at the usual time. You are cordially invited to dinner with the President. And here to entertain him and you are Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz with Vivian Vance and William Frawley. Eddie Fisher. Jane Froman. Rex Harrison. Helen Hayes. Ethel Merman. Lilli Palmer. Thelma Ritter. Jackie Robinson. Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein II. William Warfield. And the program will be narrated by Walter Cronkite and Ben Grauer. This is Walter Cronkite speaking to you from the Hotel Mayflower in Washington, D.C., on the occasion of this 40th anniversary of the Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States. President will receive the 1953 Democratic Legacy Medal of the Anti-Defamation League. But before that ceremony occurs, there are a dozen or more of your favorite people who have come here to entertain you because they, like you, are dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal and to the conviction that opinions from behind the Iron Curtain to the contrary, there's a lot that's right about America.
You're poor, you're tired, I'm tired. Enlightening the world is a very weary job, citizens, and I'm tired. I got headaches, and this is reportedly the biggest head in the world, and this tablet, not aspirin, you know. I got a lot of things on my mind. Welcome, stranger. Come right in. Watch out for those Staten Island ferry boats. I get awful discouraged sometimes, standing here day after day in this draft, getting rained on and snowed on. I get a little sensitive. I wonder if people really appreciate me. Hi, stranger. Come right in. Turn left at the battery. You can't miss. This is a very difficult job. I do the best I can. What's your trouble? Well, for goodness sake, I can't do everything. Take it up with the bread. I'm only the bronze. Ah, well, if that isn't sweet. He says, never mind the brass. Gentlemen prefer bronze. Is that cute? Love from a stranger, huh? Well, I love you, too. Maybe I better stick around for a while. Take up my stand for civil rights and against uncivil left. Welcome strangers and reassure old acquaintances. Oh, I've made a lot of mistakes in the past, but I've been the first to admit them. Look at all those amendments you've got. And I still stand, sometimes with egg on my sweet gray face, but rather I stand. There's a lot of things wrong with us, but there are so many things that are right. And we're getting better and better and better.
I'm Ben Grauer, speaking from one of the great world capitals, Washington, D.C. It's here that the ledger of freedom is kept. And here to help us strike a balance sheet is Lilli Palmer and Rex Harrison.
We say liberty has won more than she's lost.
We say she's in there fighting and winning a hard fight.
But there are debits against us. Sometimes we balance the books, sometimes we don't. Debit. Sioux City, Iowa, August 29th, 1951. First Sergeant John R. Rice, killed in action near Tabudong in Korea, denied burial in the Sioux City Cemetery. Reason? Sergeant Rice was an American Indian.
Credit. A week later, by presidential order, Sergeant Rice was buried with military honors in Arlington National Cemetery.
A wreath from President Truman graced the grave. General Walter Walker, former commander of the 8th Army in Korea, lies a breath and a sigh away. General John J. Pershing bivouacs no further distance than a century's call.
Eddie Fisher, private first class, recently of the United States Army, when asked if he'd like to sing a ballad in honor of an American Indian killed in Korea, answered, "You kidding or something? It's an honor." Here he is. We're happy to present him. It's an honor. Eddie Fisher.
Country before I was born. I gathered my loved ones around me, and I gazed at each face I adore. Then I heard that voice within me thunder, this is worth fighting for.
Anniversary of the Anti-Defamation League. 40 is our number.
It seems a very good number with excellent traditions. It was the number of years the children of Israel wandered in the desert.
It's the number of years the ADL has been fighting the forces that seek to undermine freedom and our American way of life. 40 years, World War I to Korea, Woodrow Wilson to Dwight D. Eisenhower. 40 years ago, a dinner such as this could not have been given anywhere in America. We have come a long way in those 40 years. The bedsheets of the Ku Klux Klan have been torn to shreds. The Knights of the White Camellia have withered and died. The silver shirts are tarnished and discarded. Today, when lax or bigoted or corrupt local officials fail to protect the rights of the individual, the FBI, under the leadership of J. Edgar Hoover, is required by federal law to investigate and the Department of Justice to prosecute violations of civil rights and liberties. For we are not a mob to be led by demagogues. We are a nation blessed since our founding by the leadership and counsel of wise and good men. Elder statesman, though he has never held elective office, advisor to presidents through these past 40 years, American Bernard Baruch. It hasn't been an easy time, and we haven't always covered ourselves with glory. There was a time when many colleges and universities rejected members of minority groups or admitted them on a strict quota basis. Under the leadership of Judge Meyer Steinbrink, the Anti-Defamation League led the fight, which has resulted in more than 450 American educational institutions eliminating questions regarding creed and color from their application forms. Yes, we've come a long way. In 1913, mob rule under Lynch law took the lives of 52 Americans, 51 Negroes, one white, a lynching a week 40 years ago. Today, there's still mob violence. But in 1952 and in 1953, there has not been a single lynching in the United States. Yes, there has been much progress in these past 40 years, but there remains much to be done.
I should have been prepared for this. It happens to me all the time. One of the writers slaps his brow and he says, a natural. Rex Harrison introducing Jane Froman. He's got to say it. She walks in beauty like the night. He's got to. Well, I don't got to do anything. I'm a free man. I can say what I like, so here goes. She walks in beauty like the night. Well, she does, because Jane Froman does, that is. Jenny?
Walk on through the wind.
The girl who had everything against her yet managed to enjoy life to the full. She reminds me of a quotation of Euripides, that ancient Greek of modern wisdom, whose words Bernard Shaw freely adapted and which I spoke in the film of Major Barbara. It goes, "One and another in money and guns may outpass his brother, but whoe'er can know as the long days go that to live is happy has found his heaven."
And another ancient Greek philosopher said long ago that a democracy was necessarily limited to the number of people who could be reached by the sound of a single human voice. A challenging definition, answered in the 20th century by the technology of television and radio, pioneered in this democracy by such men as General David Sarnoff of the Radio Corporation of America, Leonard Goldenson of the American Broadcasting Company, and William S. Paley of the Columbia Broadcasting System. Through the facilities of these men and their colleagues, a single voice can reach millions upon millions. A voice to entertain, a voice to communicate, a free voice speaking to free men.
Excuse me, Lilli.
Yes, sir.
I wish to communicate with the free people for a moment.
Go right ahead. It's your mic.
Mike, it's precisely the cue. We have heard those allegedly funny dialect stories about Pat and Mike and Izzy and Abe. Sometimes those unfunny jokes are crossbred. The story then begins, it seems there was an Irishman and a Jew. Or if the poverty of wit of the teller requires a larger cast, it often is an Englishman, a Scotchman, and a Dutchman. Frequently, a guest artist named inevitably Rastus gets into the act. Now, either these stories are getting worse, or our taste is getting better. Because we don't enjoy them very much in these enlightened days. But here's one I think you will enjoy. It seems there was an Irishman, a Cuban, a Welsh-Irish-English lass, and a redhead from Jamestown. And these four people, all with different national backgrounds, decided to make people laugh. These four Americans, blending the gift of many stocks, working together, created the most successful TV show since ancient Greece. That's our kind of story. That's why we love Lucy.
Well, it ought to be. It's the same team we sang it in 20 years ago.
It is?
I don't know. Hey, listen, I can't find her anywhere. I've been looking for her all over the place. I don't know what to do. Lucy, where have you been? I've been looking for you all over the place. We haven't got much time till the show goes on.
What difference does it make? I'm not going to be in the show. You said you couldn't find a duet that would fit my voice.
Oh, honey, I was joking. I didn't mean it.
Not much you didn't.
Now, look, honey, you're going to be in the show. We're going to do Underneath the Bamboo Tree.
Oh, Ricky, really? Yeah. I love that number. Oh, that's wonderful.
Now, look, you haven't got much time to learn the jokes.
Yeah?
I got to go and rehearse the music.
Yeah?
You explain them to her, Fred, all right?
Oh, yeah, you
all
explain them to me, Fred. Where are they?
Here.
Yeah, how does it go?
It's a cute routine.
Yeah?
Ricky has a little cane, and
yes,
he goes tap, 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 and then when the music stops, you tell one of these jokes.
Okay, show me how to go.
All right. Jump, 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 tap, tap, tap.
Tap, tap, tap.
How are you, Lucy?
Fine. How are you, Ricky?
You know, a tramp came up to me in the street and said they haven't had a bite in days.
What did you do?
I bit him.
Oh, no. Oh, well, come on. Let's get to my joke. Let's see now. Dum, 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 tap, tap, tap. Did you hear
no,
about...
No, I'm sorry. That's Ricky's line.
Oh.
Did you hear about the big fire down at the shoe factory?
No. What happened?
200 souls were lost. What a bafola! That'll rock 'em.
Oh, brother, I can't wait to see this tonight. He must be saving the good jokes for me. Let's see now. Dum-dum-dum-dum-da-dum, tap-tap-tap. You know, there are
I'm sorry again. That's Ricky's line. There are two things I can't have...
Just a minute. Never mind. Who does he think he is? He's saving all the good jokes for himself, or I'm just not going to do it.
Oh, now, Lucy, don't act like that.
No.
Every comedian has to have a good straight man, and you're a wonderful straight man.
Well, I want to be crooked once in a while. No, I'm not
going to
do it.
Well, all right. I don't know.
Wait a minute, Fred. Give me that. Okay, I'll do it. You run along and get dressed. I've got some studying to do.
You better hurry.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, from the 40th anniversary dinner of the ADL in the ballroom of the Mayflower Hotel in Washington, D.C., we bring you Fred and Ethel Mertz in one of their old-time vaudeville favorites.
Could be sweeter than my sweet Eve when I meet her
in the
morning, where the morning glory wine around my door, whispering pretty little stories
that I love to hear once more,
strolling with my girlie when the dew is pearly,
early in the morning. Butterflies all flutter up, the gypsy's little buttercup, and love a warning.
Hey, if I had Aladdin's lamp for only a day, I'd make a wish, here's what I'd say.
Oh, nothing could be finer
than to be in Carolina.
Than to be in Carolina. Be with you in Carolina in the morning.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we present Mr. and Mrs. Ricky Ricardo in Songs and Witty Sayings.
We'll build a bungalow big enough for two, big enough for two.
My honey,
just me and you.
Yeah.
And when we're married, happy we'll be. Under
the bamboo,
underneath the bamboo tree.
Hi, Lucy.
Hi, Ricky.
Do you hear what happened to me on the way to the Mayflower tonight?
No, what happened?
Well, a tramp came up to me in the street and said he hadn't had a bite in weeks.
What'd you do, bite him?
If you'll be M-I-N-E mine, I'll be C-H-I-N-E mine. On a L-O-V-E love you, in that T-I-M-E time.
Lucy?
Yeah, Ricky?
Do you hear about the big fire down in the shoe factory?
I bet some heel started it.
You're supposed to say what happened.
How's that?
What happened?
200 souls were lost.
You are the B-E-S-T best, so call me wreck. On a L-O-V, he loves you all that T-I-M-E time.
Go ahead.
Oh, no, I'm on to your tricks. You start it this time.
All right. There are two things that I can't eat for breakfast. Lunch and dinner.
Just like an L-A-R-K-R cult in the B-A-R-K park.
I got you this time. I know a joke that you haven't heard in your whole life.
Well, go ahead, kill it, brother.
Okay. Do you hear about that girl that was so dumb that she thought a football coach had four wheels? Four wheels!
How many wheels does it have?
Oh, what's the use? Ba, ba, ba. I'm glad you're in a hurry. Happy.
It couldn't be done. Ball players on the road live close together. They said it won't work. Vance Rickey, on the other hand, thought it would work fine.
Well, it worked all right. It worked all right. It worked fine. I don't say it was easy at first, but once we started playing together, the team got behind me 100%.
Jack, I understand that you're coaching kids in sandlot baseball. Do you find any discrimination among the boys?
Well, they discriminate in only one way, Finn. When a Negro or a Puerto Rican or a Jewish kid reports for practice, the only thing the other kids want to know is, can he play ball? It's that simple.
Well, it's simple now, Jackie, but it took faith and courage and the pioneer spirit. And so we all say thanks to you, Jackie Robinson. Thanks.
From bassists to baritones is as easy as pie on this program. But we couldn't have done it a few years ago with the stars we have with us tonight. A few years ago, Marian Anderson couldn't sing at Constitution Hall in Washington because she's a Negro. Today she's welcome there because she's a great artist. And on February 7th, another distinguished singer will appear in Constitution Hall. And tonight we have a small preview of this event, which further commemorates the retreat of prejudice in America. Avant de quitter ces lieux, from Faust, sung by the great American baritone, William Warfield.
Seigneur, Les riches de la gloire aux fins des ennemis. Le premier, le plus bravo, fort de la mêlée. J'y vais combattre pour mon pays. Et si vers lui Dieu me rappelle, je veillerai sur toi fidèle.
Pursuit of happiness. But living is impossible. Liberty a sham, and happiness beyond attainment without a job. And not always, even when jobs are plentiful, has everyone enjoyed the right to work.
I do hereby reaffirm the policy of the United States that there shall be no discrimination in the employment of workers in defense industries or government because of race, creed, color, or national origin.
Executive Order 8802, under the President's wartime emergency powers. Not a law, not nationally, not yet. But due to the aggressive leadership of men like Senator Irving Ives of New York and Senator Hubert Humphrey of Minnesota, Penn State now have fair employment practice laws. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, the sacred promises of our Declaration of Independence, echoed a century and a half later in another declaration, the Declaration of Human Rights of the United Nations, for which Mrs. Eleanor Roosevelt was the American spokesman.
Recognition of the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family is the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world.
The advent of a world in which human beings shall enjoy freedom of speech and belief and freedom from fear and want has been proclaimed as the highest aspiration of the common people.
It is essential that human rights should be protected by the rule of law.
No argument there, is there? That's what we believe. Always have. But in lots of places, these ideas are still new and full of hope. And lots of people are watching us and wondering if we mean what we say. We say we do. And when we look back across those 40 years, we realize that we've come a long way. We've proven it time and again, as our highest tribunal has handed down decision after decision, which have been milestones in our ceaseless struggle for human rights. We still have a long way to go, but we know that the journey will be undertaken with due respect for the law, as interpreted by the highest court in our land. the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States, Earl Warren. And his colleagues, including Justice Felix Frankfurter, Justice William O. Douglas, Justice Robert Jackson, Justice Tom Clark. What future questions of civil liberties and civil rights these men must decide, no one knows. But every American must feel reassured that on these issues so vital to him, he is guaranteed his day in court.
As everyone in Washington knows, the National Theater here was closed for 4 years because it banned Negroes in the audience. It had to close because no actor would play the theater until the ban was lifted. The very dynamic lady you're about to meet was the star of the show that reopened the National. Now, I'm not an ignorant man. I know quotations from Greek and everything. Yet it seems to me to be a logical mistake to assume that the D.C. in Washington, D.C. stood for direct current, and that Washington got its charge out of Miss Ethel Merman.
Like that perfume from Spain. I'm sure that if I took even one sniff, that would bar me terrifically too. Yet I get a kick out of you. I get a kick. In a plane, flying too high with some guy in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. Yet I get a kick out of you. Man, what am? Oh, my honey lamb, come on along, let me take you by the hand. Up to the man, who's the leader of the band. And if you care to hear the Swanee River played in ragtime, come on in here, come on in here. Let's go on with the show. The costumes, the scenery, the makeup, the props, the audience that lifts you when you're down. The headache, the heartache, the backache, the flop, the sheriff who escorts you out of town, the opening when your heart beats like a drum, the closing when the customers don't come. There's no business like show business, like no business I know. You get word before the show has started that your favorite uncle died and gone. And top of that, your partner has parted, your broken hearted, but you go on. There's no people like show people. They smile when they are alone. Even with a turkey that you know will fold, you may be stranded out in the cold. Still you wouldn't change it for a sack of gold. Let's go on with the show. Let's go on with the show. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. You know, there is no business like show business. And even if there was another business like show business, it'd still be show business. So there's no business like show business. Follow me? Follow me.
And now the two gentlemen that I'm about to introduce are Mrs. Show Business themselves. They wrote Oklahoma, Carousel, South Pacific, The King and I, Me and Juliet, you name it, and they've got it. Anyhow, it's Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein II. Dick and Oscar assembled the show tonight, and I'm sure they'd like to address the assembly. So, fellas?
Well, I don't want to address anyone. Just talk. Oscar and I just wanted to suggest briefly why we wanted to do this show. We thought it was a pretty good chance to put the American theater to work directly in the interest of democracy. I think the theater has a better right than almost any influence in America to speak for democracy.
We have no intolerance on our American stage, and so we can plead for tolerance everywhere else.
In other words, our house is in order. We're never at a loss in the theater for blistering names to call each other, but they're never based on color or religion.
And another thing, nobody tells us what to write.
The public tells us what it likes, and that's democracy for us. That's a republic in action and working.
And we're not talking only about the musical stage, but those quieter theaters where the words are spoken without benefit of music or singing or dancing.
No, indeed. When we say there's no business like show business, we mean show business. All of it. And most especially, when we're talking about one of the great ladies of the theater. She brings you now the finale of the last act from the Broadway success, Harriet.
The place, Andover, Massachusetts. The time, 1863. The war between the states is at its climax. Harriet Beecher Stowe, author of Uncle Tom's Cabin, has just returned from a visit to Washington. She is telling her family and neighbors about her meeting with the president. Miss Helen Hayes as Harriet.
Well, my dear neighbors, I know you want to hear about my visit with our president. Well, now let me see. When I stepped forward and put my hand into his vast prairie of a palm, I became as a grasshopper in my own eyes. He's a very tall man, you know, oh, very tall. And a plain man at first sight. But when he smiles,
Oh, then he becomes Father Abraham. 1 hour with our president has lifted my spirit and endowed me with new strength. He has made me see that this war, which seems so final to us now, is but one small pattern in a vast tapestry of struggle. Since the dawn of history, there have always been tyrants, great and small, who have seized upon and enslaved their fellow men. But equally always, there have been noble souls who have bravely and gladly given their lives for the eternal right of man to liberty. The hope of today lies in this, that we as a people are no longer willing to accept these tyrants and the world they make without question. We are beginning to understand that a world that holds happiness for some but misery for others cannot endure. Oh yes, that is our hope. Our danger is this, that when the conflict is ended and the war weariness has set in, we may be tempted to forget, to slip back into the old ways. Then, and then only, will our sons have died in vain. Then will the battle have to be fought again, and perhaps yet again. A day will come when these, our little lives, will be ended. All will be gone. All who raged, all who threatened, the weaklings who yielded, and the men who, like our president, stood and bore infamy and scorn for the truth. Yes, life will be over. But eternity can never efface from our souls whether we did well or ill, fought bravely or failed like cowards. Whether at the end we could say with truth, I have fought the good fight, I have kept the faith. For mine eyes have seen the glory.
Ladies and gentlemen, our host for this evening, Mr. Philip M. Klutznik, President of B'nai B'rith.
Mr. President, Mrs. Eisenhower, distinguished guests. On behalf of B'nai B'rith, I bid you welcome. B'nai B'rith means Sons of the Covenant. It is an organization of free men and women who believe that work and service in behalf of our fellow man are in the sacred spirit of democracy and freedom and in the holiest tradition of our Hebrew faith. The dignity of the individual is precious to us, however humble is origin or station in life. For we believe with the great philosopher Spinoza that the state has for its end so to act that its citizens shall in security develop soul and body and make free use of their reason. For the true end of the state is liberty. To recognize those who are in the forefront of the fight for human rights and liberty, our Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith established America's Democratic Legacy Award. Tonight, the 1953 medallion will be presented by the national chairman of the league, Mr. Henry Edward Schultz. Mr. Schultz.
Mr. President, Mrs. Eisenhower, honored guests, we are privileged on this occasion to honor you, Mr. President. We honor you for your leadership in the great crusade to bring about the elimination of Nazi tyranny over the oppressed peoples of Europe, for your vigorous campaign to eliminate racial segregation in the armed forces, for your efforts to end undemocratic patterns of discrimination here in Washington, our capital city. But most of all, we honor you for your continued leadership of the free world. For all these things, Mr. President, it is my privilege to present to you this medallion, the 1953 America's Democratic Legacy Award, in grateful recognition of a life devoted to the furtherance of freedom.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Schultz, ladies and gentlemen, for such an award from such a group, I shall ever be grateful. No matter how unworthy any individual may be, no matter how much he may appreciate his own shortcomings in attaining the ideals in which he himself believes, it is still a moment of the most intense satisfaction when some organization, standing as it does, as this one does, for the great human rights, chooses to present its emblem, its annual emblem, to that individual. So I thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, for many years, I have been served by able staffs in war and in peace. I have a staff now of which I'm intensely proud. It is composed of individuals who are capable, efficient, and they are dedicated to my welfare and to my success. They're always anxious that I do well, no matter where I appear. And tonight was no exception. I have been briefed and briefed and briefed. I have heard more lectures on civil liberties, the people who have stood for them, the dangers to them, what I should say, than you can imagine. Now, from the beginning, I was aware of one thing, possibly two, I should say. First, any man who is served by staffs, no matter how dedicated, must learn when to say no. And secondly, I knew that I was appearing before a body of experts, and I was not going to talk about something which they knew a lot more than I did. And so, with your indulgence, I want to tell you about an idea that came to me as I was sitting here this evening. And I saw an array of artists appear on the stage. And suddenly came back to me an old 4th of July statement. Always a speech. Speeches that the men used to make on 4th of July. Now, I'm not going to take up your time with the 2 hours that they usually spent in getting to the only punchline that they had. I am proud to be an American. As you looked at that array of arts, weren't you proud that a man's ability entitled him, or the lady's ability, entitled her to appear before such a body as this? Now, why are we proud? Are we proud because we have the richest acres in the world? I've heard that the Nile Valley is one of the richest places in the world.
Now, there's a great nation. But do you want to give up your citizenship for that of a nation that has merely richer ground? Or richer minerals underneath its soil? I've heard that the European annual production on its acres is about double that of ours. By reason of their devoted work, handwork on their farm. But we don't want to go and be citizens of Europe. We don't want to go any place, even if their buildings are older than ours, their culture older, they're more sophisticated. We love America. Why are we proud? We are proud, first of all, because from the beginning of this nation, a man can walk upright, no matter who he is or who she is. He can walk upright and meet his friend or his enemy. And he does not fear that because that enemy may be a position in great power, that he can be suddenly thrown in jail to rot there without charges and with no recourse to justice. We have the Habeas Corpus Act, and we respect it. I was born, raised in a little town of which most of you have never heard. But in the West, it's a famous place. It's called Abilene, Kansas. We had as our marshal for a long time a man named Wild Bill Hickok. If you don't know about him, read your Westerns more. Now, that town had a code, and I was raised as a boy to prize that code. It was, meet anyone face to face with whom you disagreed. You could not sneak up on him from behind, do any damage to him without suffering the penalty of an outraged citizen. If you met him face to face and took the same risks he did, you could get away with almost anything as long as the bullet was in the front. And today, although none of you have the great fortune, I think, of being from Abilene, Kansas, you live, after all, by that same code in your ideals and in the respect you give to certain qualities. In this country, if someone dislikes you or accuses you, he must come up in front. He cannot hide behind the shadow. He cannot assassinate you or your character from behind without suffering the penalties of an outraged citizenry will inflict. Now you know, I must go back for a moment to what I said a while ago. I picked up my own subject as I came here. The only responsibility I have is to watch some individual in front of me who has cards if I've used up all my time. I just noticed, he says, go ahead, it's all right. I would not want to sit down this evening without urging one thing. If we are going to continue to be proud that we are Americans, there must be no weakening of the codes by which we have lived, by the right to meet your accuser face to face, if you have one, by your right to go to the church or the synagogue or even the mosque of your own choosing, by your right to speak your mind and be protected in it. Ladies and gentlemen, the things that make us proud to be Americans are of the soul and of the spirit. They're not of the jewels we wear or the furs we buy, the houses we live in, the standard of living even that we have. All these things are wonderful to the aesthetic and to the physical senses. But let us never forget the deep things that are American. Are the soul and the spirit. The Statue of Liberty is not tired, and not because it is made of bronze, It's because no matter what happens, here, the individual is dignified because he is created in the image of God. Let's not forget. I am not going to try to be spectacular and ask us all to rise and in imitation of allegiance to flag, repeat the old 4th of July statement as I once did when I was 6 years old in the McKinley campaign. Good Republican won that year. We all said after the speaker, I am proud to be an American. But if I could leave with you one thought, you not only will repeat it every day of your lives, but you'll say, and I will do my part to make it always true for my children and my grandchildren. Thank you.
Harriet was written by Colin Clements and Floris Ryerson. I Love Lucy is written by Jess Oppenheimer, Madeline Pugh, and Robert Carroll Jr. Due to the Dinner with the President program, the following programs usually presented over many of these stations were not seen tonight. Douglas Edwards and the News, sponsored by Oldsmobile. And the Perry Como Show, sponsored by Chesterfield Cigarettes. Douglas Edwards will return tomorrow night, and Perry Como will return Wednesday night at the usual time. This is the CBS.
This is the CBS Television Network.